welcome you to the first of what we hope will be several founder events. We, collectively the board, are thrilled to thank you as founders for getting this organization up and running.
Thank you.
Some of you were at the very initial meeting before I ever met Blake, which was at a cocktail party where there were about 40, 50 people who raised money, and there were about maybe 50 founders. I'm really tickled to tell you that when the founder program closed on August 15th, we had 246. So, my theory is you make nice to the people that are nice to you. So therefore, like I said, we are going to have different kinds of founder events. Some of them, like this evening, which we're really tickled about, which is to have an academic come and talk to you about Tennessee Williams in general. I can tell you that I personally, in my world as theater, I personally am aware of a Tennessee Williams Theater Festival in Provincetown, Massachusetts, one in New Orleans, one that opens next year in St. Louis, and one that opens tomorrow, which is really amazing, in Havana, Cuba. Because I actually had somebody who was going to come to this and said, oh gosh, Hilton Havana, Hilton Havana. And he said, I love the theater, but I'm going to Havana. So I said, okay, but they are doing for the first time ever Tennessee Williams theatrical production there. I think you'll be really, really tickled to get the background sort of dirt on Tennessee Williams, and I'm very proud that Blake chose this play. I mean, it's not funny like God of Carnage, but it's really quite brilliant. And here's Blake.
Good evening. My name is Blake White. I am the artistic director and founder of Lean Ensemble Theater. And first of all, thank you all very, very much for coming. And very quickly, I just want to say, when you have this sort of pipe dream idea to start your own company, you really need two things more than anything else. The first, you need an audience. And I think that we are all lucky enough to live or have homes in a place that supports the arts beyond most communities of our size. So I knew that we had that in the bag. And the other thing that you need is great and talented friends and colleagues to come along with you and believe in your journey. As we've gone about forming this ensemble, we've had people coming out of the woodwork, and some of them are sitting right back there. That's the cast of The Glass Menagerie, right in that row. And not the fifth guy. We found him in the hotel across the street. He just wandered over. But also, you need people to help on the other side of the stage, and that's where we are very, very fortunate to have Katie Razor with us. Katie and I actually went to the same undergrad, though you wouldn't know it from looking at us. We're actually a few years apart. I graduated in 2000, and you graduated in?
2006.
I went on to Zoe Restaurant in New York City. She went on to Harvard, so we took different paths. Katie is one of the smartest people I've ever had the pleasure of working with and well-educated, and she has been incredibly helpful through this entire process, both to me and to the cast and to the board. So it is my great pleasure to give you Katie Razor.
I'm gonna put this up here so I can drink it. We're good. All right, we're good. Thank you so much for coming out. This is so much fun. All right, I'm Katie. Hi. And today I'm going to focus on the backstage drama that helped to make The Glass Menagerie what we know it today. Can everybody hear me okay? Mm-hmm. We're good? Okay, let me know. So I almost went down the rabbit hole of comparing Tennessee Williams' life to the plot of The Glass Menagerie, because it's the most nerdy fun ever. But then we'd never leave. We'd just be here all night and through the run, and I'd still be talking on Sunday. But there are a few things, I'm gonna keep it short, that you should know. Williams' mother, Edwina, really was a Southern belle. Very strong-willed, some might say overbearing. And he really did have a sister very close to his age, with whom he was close his entire life. Her name was Rose, but in the play she's represented as Laura. He was once quoted as saying that the real love story of this play is actually the story of the siblings, which I always thought was very sweet. When Williams was 15, his family moved to a tiny little apartment right on the border of St. Louis. And it was just going to be temporary, and then they were there for about 10 years because of financial constraints. And they were 10 largely unhappy years for Williams and his sister. His father pulled him out of college for kind of arbitrary reasons, and he ended up working in a shoe factory, just like Tom in the play. And in the meantime, Rose, upon whom Laura is based, her mental health continued to decline and would just get worse her entire life. So the location, the cramped apartment, and many of Williams's life experiences will turn up in the play, and you'll notice that tomorrow when you see it. Thomas Lanier Williams was his birth name, so you'll notice that the narrator, Tom, is named for him. But he officially became Tennessee when he was 28 years old. He was living in Culver City, California, trying to become a writer. And it wasn't going great. He found the closest day job he could find was 12 miles away, and he only had a bike. So he came back from his 24-mile commute to discover that he had won a contest. He had won a playwriting contest that the group theater held for writers under 25. And you're like, didn't she just say he was 28? Yes, he was. He lied about his name and his age to win this contest. And because this was his first professional mention in New York papers, he kept it for the rest of his life. So all official documents said he was born in 1914 instead of 1911 until well after he'd passed away, and everyone called him Tennessee except his family. On the momentum of winning that prize, he went to New York and got himself an agent in 1939. And with her guidance, he was able to get a Rockefeller Fellowship, which was perfect because then he could travel and write, which were absolutely his two favorite things. But it was kind of a melancholy gift for him. The night he got the award, he wrote in his diary, "If only I could share a little bit of this blessing with my dear little sister, beyond the reach of joy, perhaps also beyond the reach of sorrow." Rose had been having a lot of mental health issues. At first, the family could kind of ignore them. There are many letters in which her aunts say, "Oh, she's not ill, she just needs something to do, or she just needs a husband." But eventually she had to be institutionalized. And during this time when he won the Rockefeller Fellowship, she was undergoing insulin shock therapy for schizophrenia. It wasn't until a few years later that after 6 years of being in an institution and no improvement, Rose's mother, Edwina, authorized doctors to perform a prefrontal lobotomy on her. Williams was away at the time, and he found out via letter only after it was over. And it was really this tragedy that finally catalyzed him to write something about his relationship with his mother and his sister. But he got to work on the Glass Menagerie in earnest when he was supposed to be doing a different job. In 1943, his agent got him a job at Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer Film Studios, and they brought him on to write a film for Lana Turner, but they wanted it to be adapted from a book. He didn't feel inspired by that assignment, so he just went on writing whatever he felt like on their dime. So the first thing he wrote was a short story called Portrait of a Girl in Glass, which you can read on our website. Maybe some of you have seen it. And that was the prototype for the play. It was a story about his sister. His agent, Audrey, thought he was making $250 a week, which by today's standard, that's $3,500 a week. That's a lot of money for a guy whose mom was sending him $10 checks a few months earlier. And she was very worried that he was young. He was, only about 30. She thought he'd spend it all. So she said, "I'm putting you on a $100 a week allowance, and the rest is going into savings because you don't know what's going to happen next." She didn't need to worry, though. With his smaller allowance, he started a second savings account and started sending his mother money every week to help take care of his grandparents. He wrote to his agent, "My first obligation is to my mother and my grandparents, and any extra money that I get goes to relieving their insecurity and dependence. P.S. Isn't money beautiful? In his office at MGM, when he was supposed to be doing the Lana Turner piece, he started a screen treatment for something called The Gentleman Caller. By the end of June, MGM was completely fed up with him, and so they took the Lana Turner assignment away from him with the idea that he'd come in with some other book or play to adapt. No, he didn't. He just kept working on The Gentleman Caller. And during this time, MGM was not interested in things that hadn't already been bestsellers in books or plays, so they didn't want his original work. So when he brought the full-length screenplay of The Gentleman Caller to MGM, they rejected it, which is really lucky for us, because if they had accepted it, they would have owned the idea outright, and even if the film never got made, we probably wouldn't have the play. They rejected the screenplay, he got laid off, and he was thrilled because then he wasn't letting anyone down anymore. He went back to traveling and writing like he'd never even been there, only now he could help his parents a little bit. The following summer, he sent his agent Audrey the only copy of his first full draft of a play he was still calling The Gentleman Caller, by regular mail with no insurance. His agent got it and almost had a heart attack at the idea that this play could have been lost in the mail because he didn't want to pay for extra shipping. She immediately had it retyped and sent it to the wife of a 49-year-old producer, director, actor named Eddie Dowling. The second his wife read it, she said, "If you don't take this script, someone else is going to." Dowling was a producer, but he didn't have enough capital to get the play going by himself, so he went to a man named Louis J. Singer. He was an investment banker and rumored mobster with no experience in theater, but a lot of enthusiasm. And he completely trusted Dowling's instincts, so he said, "If you want to do it, I'll pay for it." With him in place, Dowling thought he should have someone with a little more theater experience as a producer as well, so he went to a guy named George Jean Nathan, who didn't like the play. He actually hated it, and when he criticized it for a newspaper, he would say it was bad. But he saw that the role of Laura would be a great job for his much younger lady friend. So he signed on as well. And he recommended a down-on-her-luck actress with a very serious alcohol problem named Laurette Taylor to play Amanda, the mother. 20 years earlier, Taylor had been at the peak of her career. The Russian director Konstantin Stanislavski called her America's greatest actress. Her husband was a playwright, and he wrote all the plays for her to star in, and they had many houses and pretty much lived large until he passed away in 1928. Then she started drinking. A lot. She would later call her 10 years of alcohol abuse the longest wake in history. In fact, it got so bad that she drunkenly disrupted a play she was starring in, forcing it to close. When that happened, her union membership was revoked, but even if it hadn't been, no one wanted to hire her anyway. She was a liability. She briefly got another job in 1938, but then after that, she couldn't find any work. She said all the roles out there for women who were 60, which is how old she was, were sappy little women mother roles, and she rejected all of them. By the time Eddie Dowling showed up at her apartment with a copy of what was now being called The Glass Menagerie, she was pretty much a has-been. No one thought much of her. She took the script very warily and just said, "Okay, maybe I'll look at it." Stayed up all night reading it. The next morning called her best friend and said, "This is the play I've been looking for." She went straight down to Dowling's office and didn't even bother to negotiate her contract. She was in. And she was a champion of the script for the rest of her life. Then things started getting a little more complicated. Williams found out that Dowling, the director who was 49, had decided that he would play the 30-year-old Tom himself. Despite the fact that he was almost 20 years older than Williams had initially envisioned, and only 11 years younger than the woman playing his mom. As you can imagine, the mom, Lorette Taylor, was really, really mad that anyone thought that audiences would believe that she was old enough to play a 50-year-old man's mother. And she was not going to let it go. And she didn't let it go. And a feud started between those two that lasted the entire run of the show. Williams had a very dear friend who was exactly his age in her early 30s, a fiery director from Dallas named Margot Jones. Everyone called her the Texas Tornado. He got her hired, and she was trying to smooth things over between Dowling and Lorette Taylor, so she hired an older gentleman caller who was 38, so that everyone would seem older and it wouldn't be a big deal. It didn't work. They began rehearsals in November in office spaces and friends' apartments, anything to keep the budget down, because Williams' original script called for a very elaborate set design. As rehearsals continued, Dowling started to make suggestions about rewrites to Tennessee. What he really wanted, he was a comic actor, and Tom, no offense, Matt, is not the funniest character in the play, maybe not. And he didn't feel that his abilities were being properly showcased. So he wanted Williams to rewrite it to make him funnier so he'd be more the star. Williams was actually pretty amenable to rewrites. He wasn't a diva, generally speaking, but he just didn't agree with that. So he kind of held him back politely. But Gene Nathan was not so easily denied. He made a plan to wait for Tennessee after the opening of a play and ambush him. So all three producers kind of shoved him into a corner and presented him with a script they'd written themselves for a new scene and told him that he had to insert it into the play because, quote, he wasn't really a playwright and, quote, he didn't really know anything about theater and the play wasn't very good. If you can imagine. Now, they were smart. Williams was a very skinny, kind of diminutive guy, and they knew he wouldn't have the guts to stand up to them alone. But that's why Williams brought Margot on. So he brought Margot in, she confronted them, and apparently lived up to her reputation as the Texas Tornado. Eventually, a compromise was reached. They would add a new scene, but it wouldn't be the script that Dowling had written. It would be something that Williams wrote himself, which is a pretty fair compromise. And as unpleasant as the whole thing was, it's actually really good for us, because the scene that Williams ended up writing was the scene in which Tom comes home drunk and his sister Laura puts him to bed. It's the only time in the play that we get to see them interact privately, and it's a very touching, touching moment. So it wasn't all bad. Sorry, I gotta turn the page here. Rehearsals got increasingly tense as the opening in Chicago approached. Lorette still didn't know her lines. She just kept wandering the stage with her nose in the script after everyone else was off book. It got so bad that Dowling, who was a pretty nice guy actually, shouted, "This woman is crucifying me," in the middle of rehearsal. Williams didn't like the accent that Lorette had chosen to play the role of Amanda, and he told her, rather inappropriately by today's standards, that she seemed to think it was Aunt Jemima Pancake Hour. She turned it around and said, "I'm just doing your accent." And friends of Williams who saw the play actually say that's true. Apparently, Amanda was based completely on his mannerisms, his voice. It was very much based on him. Meanwhile, the producer, Lewis Singer, sees these horrible, horrible rehearsals, and he's getting nervous because, really, it's his money in the show, much more than everybody else's. So he tries to just get everything, he's trying to fix it, but he doesn't really know much about theater. So he calls everyone together with less than 2 weeks to opening and says, "You know what? We need a happy romantic ending. Let's change the ending. Can we do that? Let's do that." Margot shut that one down in a hurry, thank goodness. But it's understandable. He was nervous. So then he went to the set designer, the very famous and accomplished Joe Mielziner, who would go on to design some of the most important Broadway sets of the 20th century, and was a protege of the very famous designer Robert Edmund Jones, and said, "Let me tell you how to do this set design. I can save us a lot of money." Weirdly, Meelsner wasn't into it. He knew what kind of materials were needed, and they were very complicated to realize what Williams wanted, and he didn't let up. Singer is really getting frustrated now, because again, this is supposed to be his show, so he says, "Fine, I'm not paying for costumes." And he didn't. Immediately, the women of the cast started trying to sew the costumes themselves, again, with less than 2 weeks to go. What couldn't be sewn, Tennessee Williams and Eddie Dowling bought out of their own pockets just to make sure the actors would have clothes on stage. Meanwhile, Williams took it upon himself to handle the props for the show. So he scoured Chicago. He was apparently particularly interested in just the right kind of phone for Amanda to call her subscribers with. Meanwhile, Meelsner was doing lights as well as sets, and as I've said, it was a very complicated show. So instead of the typical single lighting board, he decided he needed seven. Seven lighting boards. And there were so many lights, and it was so complicated, he and his crew didn't finish hanging them until 3 hours before opening, as opposed to several days in advance so that the actors can practice with the lights. Christmas Eve dress was an utter disaster. There was a blizzard in Chicago, and the theater's heating couldn't keep up, so it was freezing. On top of it, the pressure had gotten to Lorette, and so she fell off the wagon. No one could find her. On that note, I'm gonna have some more. They found her in the janitor's closet, passed out behind the furnace. She was in such bad shape, they had to delay the opening. Then when the actual opening happened, they couldn't find her again. An hour before curtain, they couldn't find her. 40 minutes before curtain, they couldn't find her. They fanned out across Chicago, and they're convinced she's drunk, right? What else could it be? No, she was trying to help. Williams had seen her dress that Amanda wears when the gentleman caller comes to visit, which is a very discussed dress, and he said the day before that it wasn't quite right. So she decided that the solution on a budget was to dye the dress a new color with less than an hour to curtain. So the stage manager finally found her over a sink in her bathrobe when she was supposed to be in full costume and makeup, dunking this dress into purple dye. And when she saw him, she picked the whole thing up out of the sink dripping, shoved it at him and said, "Get this dry, I have to wear it in the second act," and took off. Now, in case you were wondering, because I was, clothes dryers had been invented, but people didn't really have them yet. So he had to shine extra stage lights on it to try to heat it up and dry it. Meanwhile, he was fanning and blowing on it, and as Williams said, quietly going insane. Because it was either that or Amanda trails lavender dye all across the living room when she greets the gentleman caller. Edwina, Williams' mom, came all the way from St. Louis to Chicago to see the show. And she immediately sat down in her seat and said very loudly, "This isn't Tom's birthday." Oops, because remember, he's still lying about his age. But the show went well. There are mixed accounts of what she thought of it, how much she saw herself in the role. But she couldn't deny it when she went backstage and met the lovely Miss Taylor, who did an excellent job, and said to her, "So, how'd you like seeing yourself on stage?" Although she would insist ever after, even in print, that she was not Amanda, Williams's little brother Dakin said that there was a lot of similarities there. He said, particularly the scene in which she's nagging Tom to thoroughly chew his food is pretty much dead on. He also said the line in which Tom calls Amanda a witch was more than accurate, noting, quote, "Our mother could, and often did, act like one." The reviews were resoundingly positive, and praise was heaped on the script and on Taylor. And even better, Taylor credited Williams for his great script, Williams credited Taylor for her good acting, and everyone was getting along. The audience that saw the show in early in the Chicago run actually got to see a different show than really anyone else ever got to see. Williams was very influenced by German Expressionism and his little bit of time in film, so he decided that he needed a scrim down during the show that would project images, titles, all sorts of stuff. Over time, they eventually cut that, and Williams credited Taylor's excellent acting, but most people think that it's just a lot better without it. You can still read the original version. It's called the reading edition. But what we used was the acting edition, though we did refer to the reading edition during the process, just for reference. Everything was looking up after opening night, and then no one came to see the show. William Inge came to see it that weekend. He wasn't a famous playwright yet, he was just a friend of Williams's from Chicago, and he said it was perfect, like carved crystal, and the audience was less than half full, or the auditorium was less than half full. Singer thought they should close the show. At that rate, they weren't going to be able to pay to run it much longer. But the critics of Chicago liked it so much, they decided to make one more push for it in press. And it worked. Tickets finally started selling. And then the question was just, do we keep the show going in Chicago where it's a hit, or do we take it to Broadway and try to get a hit there? Dowling thought they should stay in Chicago. He's like, it's not broken. We're selling tickets. Why would we leave? Lorette wanted to get back to New York. So she started telling everyone that he was, quote, a lousy actor, and basically spreading gossip about him around town. Finally, a critic called her up and said, look, you're going to hurt the show's chances in New York, and frankly, you're being kind of mean. You have to stop. So this is her helping. She went to him and said, no. It's not that you're too old for the role. It's just your performance that's the problem. You fix that, you'll be totally fine. Weirdly, she didn't understand why that hurt his feelings. She announced to everyone that talking to him was like wading through molasses. And from then on after, he called her that damned old woman. The good news is it made for some really intense scenes between Tom and Amanda every night on stage. Finally, the decision was made to open the show in New York on Sunday, March 31st, Easter's Eve, or Saturday, March 31st. With the show a critical success, you'd think Tennessee Williams could kind of coast into New York, but he wasn't done. He got off the train from Chicago and immediately went looking for more props because he was convinced that that lampshade in the second act wasn't what Amanda would have bought to impress the gentleman caller. You would think with all this practice and success, the transition to New York would be easy. No. Three lines into the final dress, Lorette had to run off stage to be sick. And this continued the entire dress rehearsal. On top of it, there was something wrong with the sound and lighting cues, and all of them were just about a minute and a half off. So everything was going wrong. Williams's agent was just sitting in the audience, horrified. And the producer, Lewis Singer, came and sat down next to her, and he said, tell me something. You're supposed to know a lot about theater, right? Is this or is this not the worst dress rehearsal you have ever seen in your life? She said she was so upset she couldn't even talk. She just nodded. Oh, well. Just to add a little bit of insult to injury, right before opening, Gene Nathan, one of the co-producers who's supposed to be rooting for the show, decided to send newly back on the wagon Lorette a bottle of scotch to throw her off her game so that his girlfriend, who was playing Laura, would get better write-ups in the newspaper. Luckily, she didn't fall for it. She had someone send him a message saying, thanks for the vote of confidence. And still super weak from being sick all day, got someone to help her onto the stage. There were 24 curtain calls the night the Glass Menagerie opened on Broadway. Her performance and the play was a triumph. Over the next few weeks, every reporter wanted to interview this, you know, basically new playwright, Tennessee Williams. And they were struck by how young and wholesome and clean-cut he was. So they may have been a little taken aback when he was asked, Mr. Williams, do you think critics will like your next play as much as this one? And he answered, "In this play, I have said all the nice things I have to say. The next things will be harsher." According to those who knew him, Williams never fully appreciated the brilliance of Glass Menagerie. He would always credit some actor's performance or some other circumstance, never the script. And as it rocketed him to fame in New York City, he was already off on the next project, something he was tentatively calling The Poker Game, and what would become A Streetcar Named Desire. He had about 15 years of just massive success. His plays were the hottest plays in town for 15 years. And even after that, he kept writing. Since its opening 70 years ago, Glass Menagerie has enjoyed 6 Broadway revivals, 4 film adaptations, 2 for TV and 2 for movies, and Williams and his sister Rose remained close their entire lives. He even took her to see the 1975 revival of the play that she inspired. When he passed away, he left all of his money to her care. So this is supposed to be, we're leaning in like it's a conversation, right? So let's talk. Let's open it up to conversation. Thoughts, questions? Anything that struck you? Anything that horrified you? Well, I'm going to drink my wine while you think about it. Yes, sir.
Long forgotten musical, Jenny,
okay,
was based on the life of Laurette Taylor.
Really?
And Mary Martin started it in 1963.
Wow, guess she had passed away by then, yeah. Wow, cool. Was it a good musical?
I saw her in its tryout in Boston.
Yeah?
No.
But Mary Martin, that's pretty cool.
It was.
Any other thoughts? Should I get down now?
One of the things that I found interesting, I did not know that he initially asked for such elaborate scenery, because in the play that is now published, he specifically says, and he even has the character of Tom reference, unrealistic elements of the world that they're in, its memory. So what was it?
It was really the scrim. I'm sorry?
Was it elaborate in terms of realism?
No, it was more elaborate in terms of special effects to make it a little bit more expressionistic, a little bit strange. He wanted all sorts of, it was old news in Germany, but we hadn't done it in America, so he thought he was being really fancy. But like the scrim was very expensive. For whatever reason, the black on the back wall had to be a special material so that the lights would bounce off it to his specifications, and all of it got very, very pricey. But no, it wasn't more realistic. Yes, sir.
Talk about, if you can, Tennessee Williams's life.
Life. Oh, okay. He was his mother. All right. Backing it up. Okay. Williams was from just kind of a middle class family. His dad was mostly a traveling shoe salesman. His mom was the daughter of Southern Episcopalian ministers, and he was very close with his grandparents. In the play, the dad is missing. That's actually kind of wish fulfillment. His dad was an abusive man. So he kind of wished he was gone. He was actually around. He had the older sister, he had a little brother. And even though they actually really lived in Missouri most of his life, his family was largely from Tennessee, and that's who he identified with. He traveled like a crazy person. Like, I can't even keep track of all the times he spent in New Orleans, Provincetown, Mexico. Was in and out of college for various reasons. He didn't graduate until well into his 20s. And then after he became a playwright, I think he mostly, I mean, that was really, they say that plays and his sister were the devotions of his life. He was gay. He had a long time partner named Frank Merlo, who passed away before he did. But yeah, I don't have any really exciting facts for you. I'm sure they're out there.
Where did he go to school and the college, and was it an influence on him, or was he had a
too fancy?
Pardon?
Like, it all sprung from him? No, it was definitely an influence. He started at the University of Missouri, and then I know he took some classes at Wash U, and I think he eventually graduated from the University of Iowa, actually. Am I getting that right? You're nodding. Maybe? No. And you're right that he had really only done short stories until he went to college, and he had teachers that encouraged him to write plays. And it was while he was a student that his plays started first getting produced on a very small scale professional level. There was a small troupe in St. Louis called the Mummers, and they would do his plays, not Glass Menagerie, it wasn't written yet, but earlier stuff that doesn't get read so much anymore. And that kind of helped him understand how the process worked. Yes, ma'am.
When you say his father was abusive, was it physical or alcohol?
All the above. He was an alcoholic. Mostly he didn't hit people, but a few times he did knock his wife unconscious. Not necessarily on purpose. It was he'd punch through the door and she was on the other side situation. But really the abuse was in many ways more emotional. Like if he didn't like something Williams was doing, he'd pull him out of college. That happened to him a lot. He controlled things through money. He pulled their youngest son, who was really the well-behaved achiever of the family. He was smart, he was in the army, and right when he was about to graduate from law school, his dad pulled all the funding out from under him. It's just something he did. And apparently he was kind of always like that. From the moment Edwina told him she was pregnant with their first child, he just didn't like having kids. Yeah, it was just sad. Yes, ma'am. I've been trying to figure this out. I feel like it was. I don't know if it was called the Writer's Workshop yet.
And what was the extent of his writing? You say short stories, and how many of the plays?
How many plays did he write? That's a great question. I actually don't know the answer. He was pretty prolific, actually. I think there are about five that get done a lot, but he has a lot, actually. Yeah.
Well, I know this year, yes, in Provincetown, they did none. Mm-hmm. And then at least five that are not done a great deal because people know you're going to go see Streetcar.
Streetcar, Glass, Cat, yeah.
There are a couple that it's like, where did that come from? And they decided, well, we'll do it at this festival. Same in New Orleans. They pick sort of things that aren't on the beaten path.
Which are cool a lot of times.
People get exposed to things they don't normally see.
Absolutely, absolutely. Yes, sir.
You've mentioned George G. Nathan a couple of times.
Yes.
Would you place him in the context of American theater since he was a premier critic, as I recall?
Yes, I haven't done tons of research from him. Weirdly, I know he's from Fort Wayne, Indiana, because I'm also from Indiana, and that just stuck in my brain. But by the time Williams, he was really, Nathan was a champion of Eugene O'Neill. And he was a huge Eugene O'Neill acolyte. And Williams's authorized biographer, who has his own agenda, obviously, really didn't think Nathan could handle the idea of someone rising to O'Neill's level. And in 1945, O'Neill had been quiet for a little while. Nathan was towards the end of his career. He didn't die for another 5 years or so, but he was well into his 60s at that point. But he was incredibly important. I'm sorry, I don't know tons and tons. He hated Williams. He called him a Southern gentleman. And gave him negative reviews ever after. Yeah. If there's more you want to add, though, I'd love to.
No.
Okay, sure.
Yeah, I was going to ask, this all came to fruition at the tail end of the war. Mm-hmm. And how did that impact it or not impact it? Was it totally divorced from what was going on in the world, or was it?
Well, not totally, because you'll notice tomorrow night, Tom's character talks a lot about in 1937, they're on the edge of something, and they're watching all these kids out partying, and they're just about to have their lives changed. So it was in Williams's mind, but he didn't serve, and he didn't seem to, like, his diary doesn't really show that he was paying all that much attention, and I can't say I know why. What I will say is he chose 1937 specifically. That's not, even though Tom is based on him, that's not how old he was in 1937. So I think the idea of being on the edge of something, even if it's something as dark as war, was very important and interesting to him, if that makes sense.
I may remember wrong, but didn't the play premiere in the mid-40s?
45.
45,
yeah.
Right, so it's a pretty big year on the world stage.
Absolutely. They brought soldiers in to see it for the preview in Chicago, but he didn't talk about it, which isn't to say it wasn't on his mind. I just don't have that information.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah. Yes, ma'am. Yes. Absolutely.
And you mentioned has the largest collection.
Wow.
That
there's probably a link there, huh?
There's some kind of link there.
I would imagine so, absolutely. He was particularly influenced by Irwin Piscator, and you'll notice that actually when you see the play tomorrow. He really was fighting against the kitchen sink realism that had become so popular in America during this time. So for him to insist that the actors aren't really eating food and that there aren't really some of the props that they'll reference, basically, he wasn't interested in literal truth. He's interested in emotional truth, which so are abstract expressionists. So he deliberately fights against that in the play. He refers to it as a play. You don't get to forget that you're watching a play, which is the influence of Piscator in particular. And if you ever read like his stage notes, it sounds like the line design is so elaborate, it sounds like he's painting something, especially in Cat in a Hot Tin Roof. We can talk more, but it'd get boring. Yes?
Can you talk more about his sister? Was she institutionalized her whole life?
She was. She started acting a little bit strange in high school, and they pulled her out really more for money than anything. And she didn't get along with her dad, and she started having horrible stomach pains and accusing him of poisoning her. And then it just went downhill. She started having paranoid delusions. And pretty much her whole life, she was institutionalized, and Williams paid for it. She passed away, a good decade after he did, and he made sure she was always taken care of. But she could come and go. Like, she was well enough to go see that play. But Williams said, his quote was, "It comes slowly, as all horrible things do. I guess we couldn't handle it if it all came at once." So, like, over the years, they watched her just get worse and worse, you know. Yes, ma'am.
Given this is an American classic, has this been produced a lot overseas, and what's been the reaction to it?
You know, I really should have researched that. That would have been really good information.
Sam Gold is doing it right now. Sam Gold, who did Fun Home in New York, he's doing it right now in Amsterdam.
Lovely. We'll have to find out how it went. Yeah, that's a great question. I don't know. Great. Oh, yes, ma'am.
Have you ever been to the Tennessee Williams Festival in New Orleans where everybody stands in the street and yells, "Stella, Stella, Stella"?
Have you?
No, I've not.
It sounds like fun, though.
Yeah, it does.
Sounds like fun. Maybe I'll go now. Yes, ma'am. They were from all over. They're a little hard to trace because they got sent a lot of places, but they largely saw themselves as Southern Episcopalians. In fact, Williams was born, I want to say Columbus, Mississippi. And Edwina was living with her parents at the time because her husband was not that nice and traveling. But she was born in Ohio, so even though they identified as Southern, they weren't purely Southern by any stretch of the imagination. They were most of their lives they lived in Memphis, actually. So I don't know much about Episcopalianism. Does that tell you anything? No. Okay. Yes, ma'am. Oh, sure. It's the most fun. Especially the way Blake had it set up. Blake and I met before the show started, and we just talk about what he was thinking because, you know, every production's different, you know, how he interpreted the end of the play. And then I went home and nerded out and read stuff and made a website of information. And then I come into rehearsal about once a week. And if they had a question for me, I was there. And if I wasn't there, they'd text me and I'd find the answer if I could. There's one I haven't found, though. I still don't know why Tom talks about green whiskers. I can't find it, but it's the only thing I've never not found. I don't know.
Yeah, me neither.
But these questions that come up in rehearsal are every bit as rudimentary as what kind of phone would they use? Because we're right at that time where we switch from these kinds of phones to this kind of phone. And then also knowing that at that time, the phone company actually provided the telephone for you. So it was sort of like how that contract worked out. So it's sort of like, just little bits of information like that, all the way to, what is the direct correlation between Rose and the character of Laura and the crippled, the mentioning being crippled in the show and the love between brother and sister. I mean, it's a whole scope of production value that we are hoping you will see in the coming days.
Katie, I think you should tell the story about how she gets the glass menagerie, because to me, okay, that's the most important story.
I do think it's a fun one. I assume the glass menagerie, the fact that Laura has these tiny little glass figures, was just something out of his imagination, or maybe a metaphor for how fragile she is. You know, one of those things you might learn in English class. There really was a glass menagerie. Poor Rose, she was so pretty. Everyone said how pretty she was. And right before she was going to have her big Southern debut and find a husband, her benefactress died, and they couldn't afford to do it anymore. So they just sent her to a couple of parties instead and hoped she'd find a husband that way. And one of the parties was a Christmas party where, and I don't know if this was the fashion or not, she went as a Christmas tree. In this long green dress that was covered in these tiny glass animal ornaments. And when she came back, she'd gotten rid of the dress, but she'd taken all the ornaments home with her. And she kept them all, and that became, in Williams' imagination, the glass menagerie. It's bonkers, this, like, every little thing, even people's names that just get mentioned in passing would be a girl who slighted him or someone from his high school. There's every little detail. There really was a Jim O'Connor, the gentleman caller. He really did come to dinner. You know, it's kind of fun.
I just wanted to say, you know, we are very, very lucky in this small, very, very new theater company to have someone of this intellect and generosity of spirit to come and share not only with us, but for all of you. So thank you very much, Katie.
Thank you, Blake. Thanks, guys.